In March 2025, the European Space Agency brought together 300 participants from national space agencies, industry, and academia to discuss in-orbit refueling, a critical capability for the growth of in-space operations. This technology promises to lower costs, extend satellite lifespans, and support long-term missions in space. The highlight of the March session was the unveiling of Odyssey, ESA's proposed orbital propellant station. Set to be a cornerstone of a sustainable in-space transportation ecosystem, Odyssey captured the spotlight. ESA experts outlined the essential technologies required for its development, asked for input from industry, and discussed the path to commercialization. This orbiting refilling station could drive the commercialization of low Earth orbit by acting as a key customer for space startups tasked with supplying it. These companies might source propellants from Earth, the Moon, or even near-Earth asteroids. I've covered several space startups with ambitious plans to harvest propellants off Earth. For example, Kármán Plus aims to mine water from near-Earth asteroids and deliver it to low Earth orbit. Meanwhile, Argo Space plans to extract lunar ice to fuel a water-based transportation system between Earth and the Moon. Both startups stand to gain from an orbital propellant station like Odyssey. However, ESA is likely to prioritize purchasing propellants from European space startups, at least in the early stages. Before we move on to the technical challenges of building an orbital refilling station, let's briefly define some words so we are all on the same page. First, by propellant, I mean both fuel and oxidizer. Fuel is a substance that burns, such as methane, RP1, hydrogen, etc. Oxidizer is a substance that supports the combustion of the fuel. That's usually liquid oxygen, but it doesn't have to be. Other substances, such as nitrogen tetroxide, support combustion. The next issue is, why is ESA saying refilling? Shouldn't they be calling it refueling instead? The reason is, as Elon Musk has explained when talking about Starship refilling, is that most of the propellant stored is not fuel, it's oxidizer, usually in the form of liquid oxygen. So technically speaking, you are not fueling, but filling the vehicle, spacecraft or station. Okay, let's talk about Odyssey, ESA's orbital propellant filling station. Odyssey, the heart of a reusable space ecosystem. Odyssey, an orbital propellant filling station, sits at the core of a reusable and interoperable space ecosystem. This facility allows spacecraft to replenish propellants, extending their operational lives. Refilling satellites or spacecraft from Earth is wasteful because of the huge amount of energy needed to overcome Earth's gravity well. Sourcing propellants from off-world locations, such as the Moon or asteroids, would greatly increase the mobility of existing assets in space. What are the technical challenges? Key technical challenges include autonomous docking and fluid transfer to allow safe and efficient refilling, thermal management to protect propellant boil-off and loss, and interoperable interfaces to ensure compatibility across different spacecraft and operators. ESA has a number of in-space proof-of-concept initiatives called InSpock 1, InSpock 2, and InSpock 3. For this video, we are interested in the first two initiatives because they demonstrate essential technologies needed for a reusable propellant station. InSpock 1, Rendezvous and Docking. InSpock 1, or In-Space Proof of Concept 1, is all about developing and testing technologies for orbital rendezvous and docking. This is a vital first step towards building a sustainable space logistics system. Without it, a space tug couldn't link up with a refilling station. The main aim of InSpock 1 is to equip spacecraft, like reusable space tugs, with the ability to accurately find, approach, and attach to objects in orbit, such as payloads, satellites, or propellant stations. Mastering this skill is essential before expanding into a larger space transportation network. To make this happen, InSpock 1 focuses on creating cutting-edge tools, sensors, guidance, navigation, and control systems, and autonomous docking mechanisms. These ensure safe and dependable performance in the ever-changing conditions of space. ESA is teaming up with European space startups and industry to refine these technologies, reducing risks and readying them for practical use in space. A real test in orbit will confirm that the rendezvous and docking systems work as planned. Once this technology is proven, The next milestone will be Technologies for Odyssey, a fully functioning orbital propellant station. InSpock 2, In-Space Cryogenic Propellant Storage. InSpock 2 is set to develop and demonstrate technologies for in-orbit cryogenic propellant storage and refilling, building on the InSpock 1 initiative of orbital rendezvous and docking. The vision is to create a practical orbiting filling station where space tugs, satellites, and spacecraft can fill up with essentials like fuel, oxidizers, or other resources as needed. This capability promises to extend spacecraft lifespans and enable multiple missions, cutting costs and boosting efficiency. To make this a reality, several key technologies must be mastered, including long-term storage of cryogenic propellants, such as liquid oxygen, hydrogen, and methane, in the harsh environment of space. In 2024, the European Space Agency opened the door for European companies to submit proposals through competitive calls. By October 2024, ESA had chosen 5 companies to take on the challenge. Most are well-established aerospace firms, but one stands out, the Exploration Company, a space startup I've covered before. This company is developing the Nyx vehicle, designed to ferry cargo to the International Space Station and future commercial outposts. They've already secured contracts with Axiom Space, Vast Space, and ESA, the latter for ISS resupply missions starting in 2028. It's a bit disappointing that only one startup made the cut. Right now, most European space startups are focusing on building rockets to reach low Earth orbit. Orbital tugs and cargo vehicles, like those needed for InSpock 2, will likely follow after these space startups have established themselves as players in the launch market. Building a market for Odyssey. ESA understands the importance of commercializing the space economy. Philip Thomas, who is involved at ESA in commercialization efforts, said, "Odyssey must be designed to be commercially sustainable from the start. We need to start thinking about commercialization from the very beginning. We're designing a solution for a market that doesn't exist yet and should carry out commercial de-risking in tandem with technical de-risking," unquote. ESA is exploring the potential market for refilling services and the different roles European space startups and industry could play. For instance, customers who will need refilling for their transportation systems and satellites, operators managing refilling stations and propellant tankers, launch providers who will transport propellant to orbit, and space logistics suppliers, developing docking systems, fluid transfer solutions, and cryogenic storage technologies. ESA is working to identify in-orbit refilling use cases. These include supporting in-orbit service providers with extending the operational life of satellites, supporting space tugs for last-mile payload delivery, refilling launcher upper stages, and enabling sustained operations in lunar orbit. I previously reported on several space tug operations which are doing last-mile payload delivery. For instance, Impulse Space and Quantum Space both are developing space tugs. Both of these companies are US-based, so wouldn't benefit from ESA's initiatives unless they had European offices. Next steps. Currently, both InSpock 1 and InSpock 2 proof-of-concept initiatives for in-space operations are underway. Meanwhile, Odyssey is gearing up for its next phase. An open competition for Odyssey will kick off in Q2 2025, inviting qualified individuals and companies to share innovative ideas on how to make this refilling hub a reality. Here's how it will work. Starting in mid-2025, ESA will gather creative proposals for Odyssey. After that, they'll ask companies to submit detailed plans. From there, ESA will select several teams to develop their solutions simultaneously under parallel contracts, allowing multiple approaches to compete and evolve. Beyond the competition, ESA is also encouraging companies to collaborate in groups focused on in-orbit docking and refilling. These discussions will zero in on spacecraft connection techniques and propellant transfer methods, key pieces of the puzzle. It's an exciting moment for in-space operations. More space startups are jumping into the game, building businesses around moving, servicing, repositioning, and refilling assets like space tugs, satellites, commercial space stations, and even orbiting propellant stations. So, what do you think? Is it time to start building orbiting propellant stations? Should governments and space agencies take the lead in constructing them, or should they step back and fund startups and companies to do the heavy lifting? Drop your thoughts in the comments below. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching. Be sure to like and subscribe so you'll see our upcoming videos. We make videos every week covering the space industry, with an emphasis on the smaller space startups that aren't covered so well on other channels. See you soon.